Amen.
Today on the Salvation Temple broadcast.
There's going to be somebody thinking different about something. But the scriptures say they met with what? One accord. And don't go to daily. Oh, I got to work. I got to go to school. I got children to get. I got to do this. I can't come. Daily they met. Daily they met. For some people, it's a struggle to come to come twice a month. It's like, you know, taking all the breath out the body. Amen. And so we're talking about church meeting. Church meeting, want to find out what can we do better to enhance your life. Part of our attitude here is that our focus is on you. We want to develop the giftedness. We want to help you be able to follow through on what it is that God has called you to do in your life. And we want to do all that we can to help your family be strong and have a powerful witness to the people of God's great love in you. Amen. And so send me questions, information, what you like, what you think we should improve, and that, and we'll go forward with that in that way. So now let's start this lesson here, the church meeting message. Because when I was dealing with that, you know, back in the day, church meeting was the Monday night fight and the showdown. Some church meetings, you have people come to church, haven't been to church in 5, 10, 15 years just to show up to make trouble and stuff like that. But actually, as I was developing, preparing the message, the information came to me by the Spirit of God saying that we need to tremendously rethink of what church is all about. We need to rethink, rework, reconsider what is church all about. And I'm expecting that we're going to notice some things that may be different than what we see around us. And or it may be different than what the activity of some people has become. I started to say how things have morphed to become what they are. And so take a few minutes as I see this look on your face to think about why you come to church. Why you come? What do you expect before you get here? How would you like for your church to be? And then, which we're getting ready to get to in this lesson, how do you compare your sense of church in connection with what is said about church in God's word? Amen. Because, of course, we live in this world and things are going around us. We're impacted by what we see, what we hear, all of that. And it might be so that we realize that things that we've come to have be normal have found out to be, they're not what the word said. I mean, everybody else is doing it, and big churches are doing it, and it seems to be working very well. But we have to go back and ask ourselves, what does the word of God have to say about church? All right. So then in introduction, here's our first statement. The word gives the pattern for the church meeting. Or you can flip it around and say, the meeting of the church, the assembly of the people of God, the gathering into the house of God, gathering at the temple. Well, our pattern really should come from the word of God. Most, it seems like in most situations around us, which I said, tried to say the other week, that these days where we are right now, seems like the church is taking more of its pattern and its way of doing things, taking more of it from the way the world does what it does. Yeah, I mean, I've noticed, maybe you're different. I've noticed we try to make our music sound like their music instead of them making their music sound like our music. And I really don't want to get started on the quote gospel and or inspirational network kind of places in terms of how they make presentations. Remember back in the day, and it's probably still true now, I just haven't personally encountered it, but it was in the day, back in the day, they didn't want you to use the name Jesus in your song. Oh, you act like you didn't know that? They said we could get you a contract, but you can't mention Jesus because it'll offend people or whatever. But look at how the pattern and the activity of what the world has been doing, including the bebop rappers. Yeah. You know, we do a lot of bop. Churches do a lot of bop rap stuff like them. Maybe they're thinking, well, if we do like them, they'll come and so forth and so on. But whatever the case may be, I would just like to have us anchor today looking at what the Word of God has to say. Amen. About what church should be like when the people of God come and meet together. And then when I was putting this together, I heard this echo in the back of my head. What more can the Word say? What more can it say than to us it has said? Okay? Now that one pushed a lot of strength on the inside of me in terms of the fact that there needs to be a decision made. There needs to be a decision made that the Word of God is true. I know that sounds deep and spiritual and all of that, but listen, we have to have a serious sense of decision and establishment of the reality that we believe God's word is true. Amen. I mean, that we really believe that it is true. Yes. Because when we need God's word to work in our lives, God's word being the number one priority that we have, God's word being all that we say that it is, then, and we expect that the power of that word has an impact in our lives, then we need to believe it. And when we believe it, there should be some connection of doing what we believe. Amen. Now, fasten up your seatbelt. I'm going to swing by there in just a minute with some little heavy stuff. And I don't want you to be talking, leaving here. I got whiplash, you know. I want to deal with you about, do we really believe what the Word of God has to say? And what more does it need to say? I mean, when you look and see the people back in that day, when we're going over our scriptures here in Acts, the people in that day, they were doing just fine with what they had, with what they did. And why should we be any different? I mean, I don't know. Maybe there's been some religious movement somewhere. Maybe like those big things we see in Africa and India. Maybe there was a time when somebody went and preached a message and 3,000 souls were added to the church in one day. Okay, maybe. But it seems like to me, that's a good pattern to start with. Amen. And watch this too. The thing that they had working at that time is no different than what's available to us today. Amen. Okay, now I need y'all to keep looking at me. Y'all keep looking around and I'll say, you stay here with me. Because I told you I'm coming up through there. I'm going to ask you some stuff and you're going to be walking out here and got whiplash. It worked for them. Amen. The scriptures show us that it worked for them. And what worked for them is no different than what we have available to us today. Amen. So therefore, to me, it seems like it's not necessarily so much that things need to be different. Seems to me we need to work what works. Amen. Amen. What worked for them. And did you hear those things that were said about the people in that day? Wow, these people have turned up the whole wide world. Now they're coming over here. Mm-hmm. They said back in those days, these people are ignorant and unlearned. But look at them, they're working miracles. It wasn't about education. It wasn't about who you knew. It wasn't about your recording. It wasn't about your public relations person. It was about productivity. Doing the thing that God called and declared to be done. Okay, so what more can it say? What more can the Word of God say to us? It gives us the pattern. It gives us the pattern for what goes on in church. But what more can it say than to us it has said? So then let's press the issues. Let's press some issues here. I said a little while ago, I wrote down here, you should seriously consider the needs that you have. When you come to church expecting, then what do you expect? If you expect to be your needs to be met, then you have to follow through on doing what's required in order for the need to be met. Okay, let me throw this one out here real early. So if you broke and you don't tithe, then you can't expect to get better. Yes, but no, let's not deal with but today. Let's deal with what the Word had to say. When you bring all of your tithe into the storehouse, and therefore that being supplied, therefore the windows of heaven will open unto you, and God will pour out blessing more than you have room to receive. Let's start with that one. If you have financial needs and so forth and so on, well, do the spiritual application. Do what the Word said. Tithe. But of course, living in this environment, living in this society, we got tons and tons of it's somebody else's fault. Tons and tons of, well, I thought about that, but. But see, you don't understand. And your house is something different over there than over my house. So forth and so on. No. Let's just do what the Word said. I think a couple of weeks ago I said this thing about, I D-double dog dare you to just be a tither. Just be a tither. Don't give no second thought about doing anything other than that. Just keep tithing. Just keep tithing. Just keep tithing. Just keep doing what you're supposed to do. Just keep doing what you're supposed to do. And I would stand here and say to you to tell me, call God a lie. If you big bad mo, you keep doing what he say. Because he said it. If you do this, I'm going to open the windows of heaven. Yes. All right, then. So, all right, okay, let's go on. So then, let's go to the main scripture text. What works well for you in terms of, let's press the issues, what's working for you? What can we fix here at Salvation Temple Church that can be a better application to helping your lives be strong? Our main scripture text, and then our highlight point. Here comes the highlight point. Now, this is what the Word of God has to say about church in the Acts of the Apostles. So the main text, here's our highlight part. One or none. That's the highlight point. One, meaning one accord, or no accord. It's going to be one accord or none accord. The scripture in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 46, here's a verse. And they continually daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. You can say amen. Amen. Or, yeah. So. And they continually daily with one accord in the temple. One accord. Everybody say out loud, one accord.
One accord.
Woo. In this age where we are, where everybody has an opinion, everybody got something to say, everybody's got a thought, we got to consider what everybody feels like, what everybody else wants. I have a right to say, and so forth and so on. One accord. Not digging around to find out everybody's opinion, try to address everything that's going on with everybody else and so forth and so on. It says, and they continually daily with one accord in the temple. I mean, we can get down so intricate on this as to say some people like it warmer, some people like it cooler. You know, some people like it as long. Some people like this song. Some people like that kind of singing. Some people want you to dress like this. Other people want you to dress like that. Like my wife does not want me to dress like this. And she let me know that this morning. Amen. Huh? But here, there's going to be somebody thinking different about something. But the scriptures say they met with what? One accord. And don't go to daily. Oh, I got to work. I got to go to school. I got children to take care of. I got to do this. I can't do daily. They met. Daily they met. Amen. For some people, it's a struggle to come to come twice a month. It's like, you know, taking all the breath out the body. They met daily. Huh? And when they were there in the temple, you know, amen for TV and those of you who stay home and watch live stream, and you can connect on the internet, and you don't have to go through the parking lot. You don't have to deal with no ushers. You can still get the word. The scriptures say they continued daily with one accord. Where? 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 In the temple. Huh? They did whatever it took to get there. They continued daily. One more time. Just tell me one time. Where? In the temple. And you'd be amazed the fight that people have to just get to church.
Amen.
Hmm? And now, did you click your seatbelt? Because it's going to be, I'm going to do this one. I think I'm going to pass on. So just say click, click like this. Say out loud. Click, click, click. Click, click, click. It's amazing. The church is the first thing that people just throw aside. Huh? You know, they got parties. They do all their parties on Sunday. Oh, I can't come because. What do you mean you can't come? Well, you know, we got this graduate. We got this birthday. We got this special. We got this thing. I got to go do it. And then we got this. Oh, I'm going to somebody else's church. Have you invited them? Say, click, click, I got you. Come on, click, click. Okay. But, church, they met daily, continue with one accord in the temple. So then, sounds like to me, there's some prescription from God that tells us the way to have church requires some meeting together on a regular basis. And making that a priority. Amen. Huh? Remember, and it's a known fact throughout churchdom. As a pastor, pastors will tell you anywhere, whenever there's a fifth Sunday on the calendar, there's a struggle in church attendance. Because people feel like, boy, I've been to church four Sundays. Whew, five Sundays already? That's too much church. Huh? Okay. But they met daily. And as they met with one accord. Okay, and so then I'm getting ready to move on because you look like you make me feel like, okay, move on, Pastor. We heard you. But here's what I want you to consider. What does one accord mean? What does it really require, one accord? What do I have to do in order to be in one accord? Yeah, I shouldn't have to make a big deal out of, which I used to make a big deal. You can sit anywhere you want to sit. You know? I've said to us very clearly, when you come, sit to the front, okay? But I don't push you. I mean, every now and then, one time we have something say, well, move forward. Well, but okay, is that one accord? I like this seat over here. I have to, I blah, so forth and so on, huh? One accord. Because when we do that, when we meet with one accord, then God can do something.
Amen.
Yes. Okay, so, all right, so then here we go. Acts chapter 2, verse 46. And they, continually daily, with one accord in the temple, and doing what? And doing what? And breaking bread from what? House to house. Whoa, ho, ho, ho. Whoa, ho, ho. I remember back at the Word of Faith over there, and we started this touch group meeting thing. Oh, it was a big deal about people inviting other people to their house.
Amen.
It was kind of like, you mean to tell me? You want me to have people come to my house? Who gonna pay the light bill? Who gonna pay for all that extra this and that? And then you have some people, well, you know, I don't want to invite the neighbors down the street to come to my house, because then they'll see what I got up in here. And then my wife, well, now I'm going to take this one on myself. And then when we deal with you all, we find out, like I told you, this big welcome, everybody hugging each other, talking like you hadn't seen each other for a couple of months. And that means you haven't been in any contact since last Sunday. No contact, none. You haven't prayed for somebody else all week long. You didn't call anybody. You don't know anybody else's phone number. They continued daily. They broke bread from house to house. Not just call, not send a Facebook message, not invite somebody to come over. I think everybody got all real quiet. I know it's going to be like that, but I'm trying to get by this real quick. I told you to fasten your seatbelt, so here we come. You know, let alone inviting somebody to come over. Now, here's two reasons why a lot of people don't want nobody else to know what's going on at their house. Number one, folk is faking and shamming. Okay, you walk in here looking cute. You walk in here looking like it's all together. And if we run over to your house right now, your drawers is on the floor. Just where you dropped them. Amen. And you don't want people to know you got tacky stuff at your house. I used to talk about, somebody said something about how I used to talk about their cars. You know, like, we don't have to go to your house if we just run out here right quick and got in your car sitting out there on the parking lot. You know, French fries, scuzz, all, you know, all in the car and this and that. That's what house, breaking bread. That's what they did. Broke bread from house to house. And we can't even get you to give us a ride home in your car without you running out there first. Amen. Do a little touch up. So number one, folks is shucking and jiving and shamming. And people don't want you to know the real deal. How come you don't want me to know the real deal? When I know the real deal, I can pray for you and pray with you. And God will change the real deal. But oh, we find out you have a fuss and an argument. Sometimes my wife and I, we yell at each other. We haven't slammed any doors lately. Huh? How come what? Leave me alone. Okay, leave you alone. She thinks she got her grandkids here to help her. They'll jump on Pawpaw again. Well, I'm just trying to be personal because I don't want to talk about the members. You know, sometimes at our house, we don't throw stuff. We don't slam doors. We don't go to one room and stay there. But we've been having this little thing lately about, you know, having a little, that's about you and your house is there. And I'm like, whoa. Huh? Oh, okay. But I'm just trying to say that's what.
Say I'm the worst one.
Oh, I'm the worst one. I'm usually snapping and barking and won't put my socks up. But you lay your socks down and let them. How many of you guys lay your socks out and let them dry? That's right, yeah. And you put your shirt, you drop your shirt on the floor so you can pick it up. It's right there where you put it. Shake it and put it on and go on where you're going. Okay. Folks is shamming, shucking, jiving. House, breaking bread from house to house? That means I got to invite you. I got to prepare some food. I got to pay some money. I've got to make a time. I got to stop what I'm doing and have you come over and just sit there and eat at my house? Woo. Huh? But that's what they did. Say out loud, that's what they did.
That's what they did.
Yeah. See, Acts chapter 2, verse number 46. And they continued daily in one accord. With one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. Did do what? Did eat their meat with what? Gladness and singleness of heart. When's the last time you just sat down with somebody and had a joyful, glad kind of conversation about how good things are, how God is blessing, how awesome He is? Most of the time, we're going to be, well, you know Detroit, you know the children, you know my money, you know I'm sick. They did it with gladness. Singleness sounds a whole lot like one accord.
Yes.
Okay. All right, so here we go. All right, so I think it's going to be better now. I think it's going to be better from here. Let's go to the support scripture text. This is the pattern. This is what the word said, how they did church in that day. And we need to make some honest evaluation of recognizing that this pattern worked. And it worked. It still works. Amen. It's not about, well, but we live in a certain kind of society. No, the word works. And if you are in a particular kind of society, then take the word and change it. So then it will fit the word. Okay, support text, second highlight point. Praise party here and there. Look at verse number 47, Acts chapter 2, verse 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people. And when they did that, what happened? Say it strong, come on. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Praising God. And it's amazing how we have to pump people and jerk their string to get them to just praise. I mean, to just tell, when you hear me say, stand up on your feet. Some people are like, holy Lord, gotta stand up. Praising God. It wasn't like they had to beg people to praise. They didn't have to push people, pump people up to praise. It said they praising God, and because they were doing that, they had favor with all the people. And when they did that, the Lord added to the church.
Amen.
Daily, such as should be saved. Okay, I'm going to tell you, click, click, then I'm going to tell you can unloosen your seatbelt. After this, click, click. Okay? One of the reasons why God added to the church daily, such as should be saved, was because the people were praising God.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. And when we look around and we do our welcome and we say, well, how many first-time visitors do we have? And there's nobody here. And there's some of you probably been to church months and months before the last time you invited somebody to come or brought somebody to be here with you. It's because you ain't praising. Uh-oh. Hit one of those right there too, Because they put the praising first,
Yes.
Praising God. So then, and we shouldn't have to give you a formula for praise.
Yes.
You should just praise God because of who he is.
Yeah.
You ought to praise him just because you woke up this morning.
Yeah.
You ought to praise him just because he watched over you last night. You ought to praise him just because you can still breathe. Somebody take a deep breath up in there. Oh, let it out. Say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
And when people spend more time praising God and less time talking about the trouble, God has greater opportunity to bless.
Amen.
Amen. So I wrote down here on the side, work your praise and let it be a blessing to you. And it'll be obvious when people are genuinely into their prayer life, it's obvious. It's obvious when they walk into church. It's obvious when you call them on the phone. It's obvious if you see them sitting somewhere in a corner by themselves, praise, you can see it. You can know it. And so one of the main areas that we have to get connected to is having ourselves lost or having a good praise life within ourselves.
Amen.
And then when you have praise, you have favor with all people. People don't go the other direction when they see you coming.
Amen.
They don't let the phone go to voicemail when they see your number with your name. Because if they know 99 times the last time you called them, it was about some complaint or some problem. But when they call you to praise the Lord, oh, yeah, pick up. Hey, let me hear some of that. Yeah. Boom. Okay. All right. Acts chapter 2, verse 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. The highlight point was praise party here and there. You should praise God more at home than you do here. More at home than you do. And when you're praising him at home, you don't have a hard time getting people to praise at the church. Because it's a part of the regular flow. Okay, here we go. All right, I think we're done with all the tough stuff. So unclick. Say unclick if you think you're bad. All right, so now, highlight point number three, prayer power, sure enough. I started to say show, you know, but I want to be diligent, erudite. Prayer power, sure enough. Sure enough, prayer power. Acts chapter 3, verse number 1. Now, Peter and John went up together in the temple at the hour of prayer. They went there because there was a designated time for prayer. And they went there. Huh? Because they know that there's something about prayer. And if you gain a sense of appreciation, they said at the hour of prayer. Okay, that could have been the time that it started, but it also could be that how much time they spent in the prayer. You get the difference? At the hour of prayer could be 3 o'clock. The hour being from 3 to 4 could be that they spent that whole 60 minutes in prayer. And, you know, we set aside a prayer time, and then you got 47 million reasons why people can't come. Okay? But they respected the hour of prayer enough that they went to the temple at the hour of prayer. And when they were going along the way for that prayer time, miracle happened. Well, let's stay with chapter 3, verse 1, just before we go. Prayer power showing up. So I'm saying here that you ought to know that your prayer has power. Amen. You ought to know that your prayer has power to get it done. Great. I mean, it's marvelous, wonderful. Have people praying for you. You should have as many people praying for you as you possibly can get to pray for you. But you need to know that your prayer has power. Okay. So then. Power showed up. So then, now, Peter and John went up together in the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. All right, now let's move on to our next highlight point. Highlight point number 4. The name above all. That means the name above everything. I mean, when you got complicated issues going on, there should be a name. Well, we do it in the song. There is a name that is above all of the complicated issues. There's a name that is above every item, every activity that seems to be beyond anything that you can handle. There's a name. And we need to know that name. Do you know the name? See, you got to do it in a personal way. Do you know the name? And do you know it as being the name that is above all? And when you know it as being that name, then when the time comes, you will say the name. Amen. You'll say it. I mean, you'll say it even before you comprehend all of what's going on. You still just say the name because you know that name is above all. Look at this verse, Acts chapter 3, verse number 6. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I have none." It's kind of like, you know, in our vernacular, this a poor man talking. And how much we complain about not having enough? How much we give up our sense of pride by letting the government take care of us, by working those schemes to make sure we get them to do stuff for us, and they'll give us something. And I driving through, you know, we use EBT cards over here, and we use WIC, and we use that, and we succumb to this entitlement mentality that says that the government, give me, I want my stamps, I want my phone, I want my this, I want my, and ain't worked a slick. Huh? This man said, I don't have any silver. I don't have any gold. I don't have access to any government program, but I got a name. Oh, come on now, work with me up here. I'm getting ready to go over somewhere. I have a name. Hallelujah. You looking up here, want something, give me something, give me some alms, give me something. No, I ain't got no silver gold. I don't have any gold, but I got a name. He said, Acts chapter 3, verse number 6. Then Peter said, silver and gold I have none, but such as I have, I give, such as I have, give I to thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. I know this is going to sound tragedy. I know this is going to sound old fogey, but sort of like, here we're pushing this business about national health care, the Affordable Health Care Act. Amen. And people selling their souls. Yes. And people getting rah-rah and snarkle. And then nah. And the health care is in the name. I know it sounds, all that's cute. That's nice, Pastor. But so-and-so and thus and this and that. Listen. Some hospital visits around here will cost you $100,000. Have you ever read your hospital bill? You know, that time they come in and say, here, drink this pill. They give you a little old pill, a cup of water, and later on you look at the bill, it was like $4,700 just to give you a pill. But yet, the word of God said, in the name. Well, I know that's nice, Pastor, but I said, remember, we're not going to deal with but today. Let's just decide that this is true. And let's at least receive it and do.
Amen. Amen.
What it says. And some people are going to stand up and drop their stuff and walk off. This is not something you do in some big missionary meeting, some big evangelistic meeting. You know, they had this big meeting. People come up with their crutches and they throw them down and they got wheelchairs pushing them. No. This is an everyday position that we can have working in our lives. Amen. And I told you to take your seatbelt off, so you're good. And if you wonder why it's not working for you, it's because you don't believe it. Now I got to move on. All right. Okay, here we go. I'm getting ready to close now. I'm more than halfway done. So let's do highlight point number 5, God's power in the name. That's kind of like me want to ask you, what is in the name of Jesus? God's power. God's power is in the name of Jesus. Where can I find God's power? In the name of Jesus. When I say the name of Jesus, because I believe the name of Jesus, what am I releasing? I'm releasing God's power. So say out loud, God's power is in the name of Jesus.
God's power is in the name of Jesus.
Okay, and one says that's why we shouldn't use it flippant and lightly, because that's like giving a shotgun to a child with a hair trigger. You know, the gun has a hair trigger. You give it to the child don't know what's going on. You can hurt something.
Yes, that's right.
But the power of God is in the name of Jesus. Okay, so here he says it, Acts chapter 4, verse 10. Is that the one we did, or were we doing 3:6? Okay, so he said, rise up, walk. He got up. Here comes again, God's power in the name. Acts chapter 4, verse number 10. Be it known unto you all and to all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. The biggest thing rolling through my head is to say, don't be ashamed of the name. Don't be ashamed of the testimony. First, have a testimony. Use the name, believe the name, stand on the name, trust the name, say the name. And then when the manifestation comes, don't be ashamed. Anybody ask you, well, you know, it was I got lucky. Not about luck. It's a power in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm standing here before you because of the name of Jesus. I should have been dead. I still remember looking down the barrel of that policeman's gun. I saw that little red circle. And he was shaking his hand and he was screaming and yelling into the car that I was in. And I had reached down to pull up the emergency brake. And he was like, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. And just think, just in that split second, less than a split second, he could have made a wrong judgment and pulled that trigger. Now you say, well, no, it was because of the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm standing here. Amen. Because of the name of Jesus. And it's important for us to find a place connected to the power that's in his name and not be ashamed. That's why it bugs me. People don't want to use a name in a song. They'll skip a contract and go someplace else. And they'll keep the name out just to get the contract. Okay. All right, I'm done. Highlight point number six. This is the last one. Highlight point number six. It said, any reason to praise. Any reason to praise. We're going back to that same Acts chapter 2, verse number 47. Because this is what the Word of God, this is how the Word of God talks about church meeting and what should go on in churches. And when it talks about praising God, I'm not trying to say to us, okay, so now we got to come in here and fake like we're praising. Now we got to come here and make people see, look like we're praising. Now when we stand up, we shouldn't frown, but we should just stand up. Now, I'm not talking about any of that. I'm talking about understanding. I'm talking about receiving. I'm talking about recognizing in your own life the reason that you have to praise God. Amen. And don't hold back about it. Yeah, there's places, you know, you go, they'll pump you up. They'll drum you up. They'll flash the lights. They'll beat the drum. They'll string the organ, all of that to make people pray. You shouldn't have to be made to praise.
Amen.
Any reason. You got any reason? Say out loud, yes, I do. You have any reason to praise God? Is there anything at all that you have to praise God for? And when you do, then praise him. And you will. Remember, praise here, praise there. You get into the flow of praising God. And you praise God more out there, so to speak, then when you come in here or in any place you go, it's not a scuffle, not a struggle to praise. And because the praise of God is in the heart and in the lives of the people, he will work miracles.
Yes, he will.
He works miracles. Okay, so here's our teaching. Well, praising God, Acts chapter 2, verse 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily. It seems like it must be that the Lord adds to the church daily because preachers have quit wearing ties and they wear jeans and tennis shoes and baggy clothes and they look scruffy. Because that's, I see that everywhere. I just see it everywhere. I mean, they make, listen, if I just wear, how come you just can't walk in with what you wear every day? Why do you have to look scruffy? Why do you have to look baggy? Why does your shirt tail have to be? My wife made me put my shirt tail in this morning, my sweater tail. And it was going to be covered up in the jacket. But now they wear the shirt tail hanging out the coat. You know, they want you to see that their shirt tail is out. And I'm like, why? Why? Huh? And then she said, and then you want to be like them. I'm trying to get her to let me wear some jeans and my Crocs up here. And what else?
Amen. Do it, Pastor.
Oh, yeah, right. He's standing back here with his cutoff shorts on and his titties. Yeah, do it, Pastor. Do it. But please stick to my point, because I'm really finished. It's like 12:12. I'm really finished. My whole point about the Lord added to the church daily because the people were praising God. Amen. And because they were having favor. Yes. With all the people. The Lord added to the church. Listen, he didn't add to the church because they had feeding programs, because they had bouncy little things kids jump up and down in. He didn't add to the church because they have waterfall activities at the church and all this other kind of stuff. See, he added to the church because people were praising God. And when they were praising God, they had favor. Yes. With all the people. Why would God want to give people favor for you when you not represent him well, when you whining, crying, grumbling, and complaining? When you're praising him, he wants people to give you favor so they can find out why you're praising him.
Amen.
That you're giving a good report and a good witness of who he is. Okay, okay, all right, so I'm gonna stop. Teaching point, this is the truth. These scriptures, this is the truth. This is the way they did. This is the way they did what they did. Yeah. They didn't need all of the fandangle stuff we do today. They did what they did. Didn't have a cell phone in the house. Didn't have any Wi-Fi. Didn't have any World Wide Web. They did what they turned the world upside down. Yeah. And people still talking about them. I mean, we're talking about them now. We're reading these verses again because of what they did. So this is the truth. Let's accept it. This is the way. Let's do it. You settle up on the inside of yourself. Spend some time with God. Say, okay, God, Pastor is talking about praising you. What's the best way for me to praise you? When should I be praising you? How can I praise you? What is the way? He said that when I do that, you'll give me favor with all the people. And when I do these things, you're going to add to the church daily. So that means watch this, watch how this goes. That means starting now, and the next Sunday's coming up, we're going to have more and more people come to the church. Because you are praising God.
Amen.
Say out loud, I will praise him.
I praise him.
Yeah. You praise him, people will come to the church. Huh? Okay, so then you ask him, see what he say. Action point. Get real, for real. Genuinely confront your own personal praise life and see what it looks like in the sight of God. Can you really genuinely tell God, I'm praising you? You have to sit me down sometimes, God, because I'm cutting up so much. I'm talking about not at church, no, at house when ain't nobody else looking around. You praising so hard, God had to, okay, babe, I got you, I heard you. You screaming and yelling how much you love God. You going on and on and on. You turn the TV off and you just praise him. Your kids bring you some issue or they're going on something, and all you do is just praise God. You don't run and find all information about it. You don't find out how long it's been, how deep it's been, how hard it was. You just spend time praising God, amen. Praising God, until God has to say, okay, I got it. Okay, I got you. Okay, so get real. Get real about your own praise life. Get real about your own sense of one accord.
Yes.
Check yourself out about the things that bug you when you come to church. Because the necessity is necessary for us to be on one accord. And when we do that, miracles happen. And then finally, determination point. Decide and do. Do it and decide that it's right. Decide that it's right to follow the pattern that God has given for the church meeting and then determine to do it. Do it and decide that it's right to do because you did it, because it's in God's word. And when you see the manifestation of the blessing, you give him thanks for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me invite you to stand up on your feet if you will. Thank you for those of you on the call. Thank you for those of you watching on our YouTube channel. Thank you for those of you who go to our website, stc.church, and review some of the information that is there. And especially for those of us here in the house, it is my prayer that God will anchor on the inside of you the realization that his word sets the pattern for how the church meeting ought to go and how church ought to be. And then therefore you can expect that your needs will always be met. Focus on this business about breaking bread from house to house. And for me, I'm just saying that like this. Get to know one another here. Right here. Get to know one another. Get somebody's phone number. Get close to somebody, close enough that they can say, I need you to pray about thus and so. And you're like, boom, you're on it. And they'll come back and tell you, you know that thing I mentioned? God has turned it around, thus and so, and this and that. We need each other here.
Yes.
And the best way for us to be strong is to get to know one another.
Yes.
And support one another. Pray ye one for another. God bless you. Let me offer to you at this point the gospel. The gospel is found in the gospel according to John chapter 3, verse number 16. The words of that verse are going to be on the screen, and I want us to say it together out loud because this is that, as it were, that entrance way into the things of God and kingdom of God. The gospel according to John chapter 3, verse number 16. Let's read it together. Ready? Read. For God so loved the world that whosoever should not perish but have. That just turns me on every time I read it. This gospel pointing us to salvation. Isn't it wonderful to be saved?
Amen.
I need it stronger than that. Isn't it wonderful to be saved?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, this salvation is found in Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Those words are there on the screen as well. Let's read it together out loud. And those of you watching, read too. Ready? Read. That if thou shalt
confess with thy mouth,
yes,
the Lord Jesus,
and shall believe in thine heart,
that
God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt
be.
Salvation is the most awesome gift, the most awesome relationship that you can have with God. So let's pray this prayer together out loud. Say, God in heaven,
God in heaven,
thank you for today.
I believe that your word is true.
I have seen, heard, read, and said the gospel.
I've seen, heard, read, and said salvation.
I believe that your word is true.
You love me so much.
You sent your son Jesus to die for me.
He died on the cross.
He was buried in a grave
for me.
But you raised him from the dead
for me.
And I receive him now
as my Savior,
as my Master.
And I make Jesus
the Lord of my life.
Thank you, Heavenly Father,
for your great love.
In Jesus'
name,
I declare
I'm born again.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Check our website.
Get information about what's going on here and how we can be a blessing to you
in Jesus'
name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for the Salvation Temple broadcast. We'd like for you to join us for our weekly services, Sunday at 10:45 a.m. and Thursdays at 6:45 p.m. Or join our services via conference call by dialing 530-881-1212 and entering the access code. We look forward to seeing you at Salvation Temple Church, where the focus is on you.
Welcome to Salvation Temple Church, where the focus is on you.